अरे अनिरुद्ध,
हेलो डॉक्टर आरिफ।
सर के बोलो वही आरिफ, टेल
हाँ
सर
प्लीज मेक मी
टू
होस्ट। डॉक्टर आरिफ प्लीज मेक मी होस्ट।
अनम्यूट, आरिफ अनम्यूट प्लीज।
बारी सर,
यस
यस सर, यू वांट टू से समथिंग टू मी सर?
नो, ये टेल जूनियर सर
यस
टू
सर।
स्टॉप दिस स्क्रीन।
ओह सर, आई ऑलरेडी। जुजुला सर, कैन यू प्लीज स्टॉप द स्क्रीन टू स्टार्ट द सेशन
आई
फॉर
कैन।
फॉर फॉर कपल ऑफ मिनट्स, देन यू कैन कम बैक अगेन।
ओके ओके।
Okay, otherwise, sir, you can stay there. We can start from here. And now I am making the Samsuluda sir.
Okay.
The Samsuluda sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Fine. Fine.
Samsuluda sir, as host. Samsuluda sir, I am making you the host, sir. Samsuluda sir, can you hear me? Samsuluda sir, can you hear me? I think Samsuluda sir got disconnected. Samsuluda sir, can you hear me?
Nobody can hear Arif. Adekulay also is chatting. He is not hearing anything.
I can hear you.
Dr. Arif, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. I am making you the host, sir. Sir, can you hear me? Samsuluda sir? Samsuluda sir, can you hear me?
Good afternoon, Bari sir. Good
Yes.
afternoon, Arif sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Samsuluda sir, can you hear me?
He is working, Arif.
No, sir. Samsuluda sir will do the live streaming. So I need to deliver the host status to him. So I am waiting for his response. Everybody, you know that today is a great day for Kurgan Bangladesh Kurgan Fellow Group because the renowned professor Dr. H R Jhunjhunwala, senior consultant orthopedic surgeon and ex-president Assami India, ex-president international Assami and bone reconstruction, also ex-president of Indian Orthopedic
Doctor
Association
Arif,
will be
am
with
I
us.
audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible. I am making you the host, sir. You are again disconnected.
I cannot hear you.
Okay. Can you hear me, sir, now? Can you hear me, sir? I can hear you. Sorry for this delay. We'll start. Sir, I am making you the host.
I'm leaving the meeting and joining back. I'm not getting the audio.
Okay, sir. Just do it on time. Sorry, we have to wait for a couple of minutes because.
Okay. Okay. No problem.
Yes,
no problem.
Yes, sir. Samsuluda sir will be back with his new ID. Then we'll make it the live streaming. And you know about the Kurgan Fellow Group. We organized this webinar from the 17th of the last month, and so far we completed the 17th lecture. And today is our lecture 18. And everybody, you already know about our speaker. And today is that their additional announcement. After the lecture of Jhunjhunwala sir, Sritesh Nesari sir will present one of his congenital pseudoathesis of tibia case, and we will go for it after the completion of Jhunjhunwala sir presentation. Okay.
Sritesh.
Yes, sir.
Jyoti, hey, happy birthday.
Thank you, sir. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Happy birthday from me also, Shatish sir.
Thanks, sir. Thanks, everybody.
Yeah. Without cake, eh? Without cake.
yesterday we celebrated.
Oh.
May I have virtual cake?
Samsuluda sir, can you hear me now? Samsuluda sir, can you hear me? Please, we'll take a few minutes for Samsuluda sir. Samsuluda sir?
Yes.
Samsuluda sir? Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, please.
I make you the host, sir. Yes, sir, you are now host now. You know that this program will be live streaming on Ortho TV online. So within minutes we will start, and you already know that today our speaker is Dr. H.R. Jhunjhunwala, and I request Jhunjhunwala sir, please you can start your presentation, sir. Wait for 1 minute.
Yeah.
Live streaming is not started yet.
Okay, just let me know when should I start.
Yes, sir. Samsuluda, sir, are you connected with us? With the permission of Bari sir, there is maybe some problem in live streaming. I think we can start now. If Samsuluda sir comes again, then we can make it. Ashok Sam sir is just want to connect with us for live streaming from Mumbai.
Arif.
Yes, sir. Sorry,
probably we can start. Already 15 minutes. 4:15.
Yes, just a minute, sir.
Because
Ashok Sam sir is just with us. Ashok Sam sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Sir, should I make you the host now, sir?
Yes, you can make me host, I can start.
Yes, sir, you are host now.
I request
Ghulam Farooq sir to mute your microphone. We are waiting for the live streaming. Sorry for this delay, and sometimes the network handling and other problem, this type of issue comes again and again. Ashok Shyam sir, can you start, sir?
Yes, sir, I'm trying.
Sir, it is better we can start. If you can solve the issue, you will be remain in host for a couple of minutes. So you can you try to solve this, and we please we want to start now, sir.
I think you can go ahead.
Yes, sir.
We can start.
Yes, thank you, sir. Junjunwala, sir, so there are some technical issue. If we solve the problem, then we can go to the live streaming from that area at that time. And now we can start the session. I request you to please continue your session, your speak on CPT and non-union TBI.
Okay, can I start? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, you can start now, sir.
Okay, fine. So I'm going to, my dear friends, good afternoon. Especially Dr. Bari and Dr. Arif and others who are going to hear this lecture. I'm going to talk on congenital pseudoarthritis of tibia. Congenital pseudoarthritis of tibia remains one of the least understood most complex and most difficult to treat orthopedic problem. There is a failure of normal ankle fracture. Very rarely, pseudoarthritis is present in at birth. Most develop pathological fracture later on. The exact cause is not known. This disorder is not a single entity, but rather a syndrome of several different pathological conditions. Neurofibromatosis is one of the most common causes. Second cause is fibrodysplasia. Third cause is it causes a congenital ring on the lower 1/4 of the leg, and that ring causes a pressure necrosis on the bone itself. It constricts the skin band over lower half of the leg, and hereditary, reported by a few authors. The pathology is the site of pseudoarthritis usually surrounded by thickened periosteum and a heavy cuff of fibrous tissue. McIlvenny believed the presence of hematomatous proliferated soft tissue interference with bone production and normal callus formation. This hematomatous proliferated tissue, soft tissue, interferes the production of callus. It was also seen that the tightly adherent thickened band of fibrous tissue constricts the bone, decreases the blood supply, and causes osseous atrophy due to the pressure. Another hypothesis has come out that there is an aggressive osteolytic fibromatosis. The younger the child, more aggressiveness is the lesion. With growth, the aggressiveness of fibromatosis diminishes until puberty. Classification is Anderson's classification and Elizabeth's classification, and later on Dorr-Pallet's classification. Anderson's classification shows dysplastic type, cystic type, late type, clubfoot type, angulated pseudoarthritis. Some people follow the Bard's classification in which six types have been discussed. Dysplastic type is the diameter of the tibia is narrowed, sclerosis present, partial or complete obliteration of the medullary canal. Uh, our glass constriction of the bone, tibia is both anteriorly or anterolaterally. Rarely fracture is present at birth. Spontaneous fracture when child walks and goes into pseudoarthrosis. This type is notoriously prone to non-union and refracture. Neurofibromatosis is always present. Cystic type. No significant narrowing of the diameter of the tibia. Cyst-like lesions in the affected segment. Tissue resembles fibrous dysplasia. Slight but definite anterior angulation of the tibia gradually develops. Leg type. Leg appears to be normal in early life. Affected leg may be shorter. After minimal trauma, a stress fracture, which consequently develops into pseudoarthrosis. They develop progressive anterior bowing between the age of 4 and 12, calling stress fracture and pseudoarthrosis. Club foot type. Fracture is present at birth, marked anterior angulation, associated with constricting band and associated with club foot. Is due to the corrective osteotomy of anterior bowing of the tibia, which goes into pseudoarthrosis. Clinical features. Anterolaterals are anterior bowing. Bowing increases and develops fracture and pseudoarthrosis. Rarely at birth, fracture is tibia is seen, which is checked. Secondary to cystic lesion. If there is a cystic lesion, you may see spots, deformity of the spine and club foot. Isolated congenital pseudoarthrosis of fibula is there. Radiological features. There may be cyst formation. Sclerosis at the pathological portion of the tibia, ground glass appearance, angulation, hourglass thinning, loss of medullary cavity, fracture through dysplastic site, and established pseudoarthrosis. Treatment. Treatment of CPT is one of the most challenging problems. Surgery is the only way to obtain union. There are a large number of operations described in literature associated with high rate of failures and complications. Currently, the following procedures are popular. One is Elizarro method, and second is vascularized fibular graft. The recommended age when surgery is to be done is between 2 and 4 years. Technically, the whole hematomatous and fibrous tissue must be excised. The bone defect can be treated with end-to-end compression and lengthening of the higher level, lengthening by corticotomy at higher level. Or the defect can be filled with bone transportation. The fibrous tissue and sclerotic bone should be resected till the bony ends bleed with open medullary canal. The bone excising the bone till the bony ends bleed little, which is called paprika sign. Then you open the medullary canal proximally as well as distally and the compression. You have to take an incision like straight, Z-type, because if you take a straight incision and if you excise this much portion, the skin closure becomes difficult. So if you have a Z incision, then even after excision of this, you can do the skin incision, the closure properly. So you have excised this portion, which is bad and pathological, so, and open the medullary canal proximally as well as distally. And then try to compress both the this gap, fill up with the lower portion of the tibia, bring it up and fill up this gap and do the compression at this side, because they should not displace when you are putting your iliotibial frame. You can put a one K wire from lower down to upper side so that there is no displacement of this portion and it is compressed here. Then you do the corticotomy here and put your iliotibial frame, one ring here, another ring here, third ring here, and you bring the corticotomy at this level, do the lengthening so that a good callus or regenerate formation occurs. Meanwhile, this is a compressed so that this heals up and you get a proper length of the tibia. If the same way here, you do the bone grafting here and do the compression. If your ends of the bones are like this, you can do side to side fixation and a compression here so that, and corticotomy at the higher level to bring the limb length equal. If your bones are like this, one is pointed one and one is broad one, you can do the telescopy of the bone ends after clearing those material, fibrous tissue, do the corticotomy here to bring the length proper. Another case here like that. Did you follow this?
Yes, sir.
You followed what is to be done here. Excise the whole hematomatous tissue, fibrous tissue, periosteum, bone, everything. So there are some case presentation I am going to do. This is a girl, you can see here, there is anterior angulation. It is five centimeters short clit. This is, you can see here, I have anterior angulation, pseudoarthrosis here. And this girl was operated 4 or 5 times. And then you do excision of this bone, all hematomatous bone, do the corticotomy at the higher level and start distracting here and keep the compression here so that this is the clinical picture of this girl. This is the compression between these two rings and there is distraction between this ring and this ring to get the length of the foot, length of the leg. And this girl could sit and walk with this frame. So this is after the frame was removed when the length was equal. And you can see here the correction. Complete normal leg, complete correction, and normal union. The X-ray shows a good regenerate formation here. And in the end, you got a very good healing at the compression site and very good regenerate formation. And this happens in about 11 months. This took 11 months. In the children, it takes about 10 to 12 months. But in adult, it takes very long time. Another case, you can see here, there is an anterolateral angulation here with shortening. X-ray, anterolateral angulation, pseudoarthrosis. You can see here, this girl was operated 3-4 times where plating was done and nailing was done and still the fracture did not unite, as literature says that there are a lot of complications and results are very bad after all doing all these internal fixation for congenital pseudoarthritis of tibia. So this was the after opening, this was the fibrous tissue. You can see here this bone is white and avascular, which is excised from here to here. This was the bone excised, and then this left out bone of the distal part and the proximal part, they are brought together, and by Elisar frame it is compressed. So this is with the clinical picture of this girl. And this, whatever the bone has formed here was very thin. Though the pseudoarthritis healed up, a good regenerate here so that length become equal. That's why, but the bone was very thin and therefore I had given a caliper for 1 year so that the bone becomes thicker. Once the bone becomes thicker, then you can stop using the caliper. Another case, again, anterolateral bowing here, anterolateral bowing, pseudoarthrosis. This boy was also operated with plate, with nail, bone grafting, but still could not have good result. The same thing has been done, the excision of the pseudoarthrotic tibia, compression, corticotomy, Elisar frame, and you can see the final result normally. In another case, you can see so many scars here. This was for nailing, for plating, for excision. So many scars for this boy, and still pseudoarthrosis was present. Still, you can see here pseudoarthrosis was present, and then the excision of the all this portion from here to here, and this portion was brought here and that did the compression here, and a corticotomy was done here for lengthening. So this is the final picture of this leg, which is looking the as normal as possible. Another case with pseudoarthrosis, 4 centimeter short. Same thing has been done, compression, lengthening at the higher level. After excision of the pseudoarthrotic tibia, heavy that hamartomatous fibrous tissue, and then Elisar fixator and compression and corticotomy and lengthening. Another, you can see here the same boy, this is united with slight anterior bowing, but clinically it was looking normal and length was equal. This boy is about 18 years now and they're doing very well. Another case, same thing, pseudoarthrosis. This is after final picture. You can see here final picture. Another case, pseudoarthrosis of the tibia. Same thing, compression, corticotomy, and this is the final union after Elisar. So, pseudoarthrosis tibia. We have done one case with microvascular fibular graft. This was the leg which was pseudoarthrotic here. You can see here pseudoarthrosis. This foot is deviated like this. That's why it looks like a club foot, but it is not a club foot. It is just a straight foot, and it was at this pseudo-arthritic level, it was turning on this side. So it was the opened up a vascularized fibular graft was taken from the other leg and it was put here. X-rays you can see here, and that graft was fixed with the plate with the whatever tibia was there, and in the end the pseudoarthritis healed up. You can see here it healed up very well. Anyway, support so that there should not be break for 1 year. But when you do vascularized fibular graft, the shortening remains. But in Elizaru, you can do shortening at the same time what is necessary for pseudoarthrosis of tibia. And you can do lengthening also at the same time. So 11 cases of congenital pseudoarthrosis of tibia, age between 4 and 14 years, 10 cases treated with Elizaru fixator after excision of hematomatous tissue and bone, primary compression after excision of the tibia, fibrous tissue, and corticotomy at proximal end of the tibia for lengthening. One case treated with microvascular fibular graft, but it's required lengthening by another surgery. By using Elizaru fixator, you can correct the deformity and lengthening of the tibia together by one surgery. Results are excellent by Elizaru technique. Thank you very much. Any questions?
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation. And sir, for question answer session, should you continue the next session? And after that, we can go for question answer session, or you want to just have question?
As you like.
Sir, you please.
You allow Shotish to same case present, then sir will talk next one.
Okay, sir.
And we'll finish this one. We'll finish this one talk and then he will present next one. Otherwise, everybody will, forget the questions.
Okay, sir. Sir, you take a rest for a couple of minutes, and Shoshit sir want to present one of his cases with pseudoarthrosis. And after completing the pseudoarthrosis tibia, we'll go for the tibial non-union. And in between, go for the question for pseudoarthrosis, sir.
Okay.
Sir, can you please stop the screen share now, sir? Shotish sir, can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Please get ready. After the stopping the screen share, you can share your screen.
Yeah.
Junjunwala sir, can you can you please stop your screen share?
Junjunwala sir, to uthe table theory mone ekhane nai.
Dr. Manuddin, can you please stop your microphone so that noise is less?
Arif, can I share my screen now?
Yes, sir, you can share. Please try.
Because in some of the this thing, if you share automatically, that the previous presenter screen share will go off. Okay, so I will try.
Okay, please try,
yes,
sir.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everybody. I thank Bari sir and Dr. Yes, Arif.
Sir,
for,
you shared your screen, sir, already?
Yeah.
Dr. Arif.
Yes, sir.
Please, previous screen was seen. So, first, you should stop the
Nazmuddin, please wait for
some minutes. Try, Shotish, you try with this. Junjunwala sir already left. So, keeping the screen here.
Are you seeing my screen now, sir?
No. I think Junjunwala sir. Sir, now yes. You can share your screen.
Yeah, I will share it again. Once again. Sir. Okay, can you see now?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks. I thank Bari, sir, Dr. Arif for allowing me to present my experience on treating congenital pseudarthrosis TBR in my setup. So I am basically I'm practicing in a government hospital. It's a medical college, government medical college. And it is attached to a government district hospital in Belgaum, Karnataka, India. So, it's not moving. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So, this is a 7-year-old boy. He's a very poor chap. And actually, the teacher of the school which this boy is studying, he brought me because I corrected some of the CTVs of the same school. So the teacher brought me this patient. He's a 7-year-old boy by name Javed. So he presented to me with this kind of picture. He had a bulbous swelling in the distal tibia with severe deformity. So this was the X-ray picture of the same patient. Normally, this type of patients, so that is the CPT patients, they are mistaken by many of the orthopedic surgeons as a distal tibia fracture. Normally, as Junjunwala sir mentioned, normally they present.
Mute your microphone.
Usually they present with a fracture-like picture. So previously they will be having a tubular CPT. With the trivial trauma, they get fracture. And many of the orthopedic surgeons, they think that it is a traumatic fracture. And they end up with doing these things like fixing with K-wire, fixing with screw, fixing with plate. And again, they end up with non-union. So basically, these patients will be Crawford type 4 type of CPT, and they end up with a very bad CPT. So this patient, as you saw, because of the previous surgery, there was little bit inflammation at the CPT site because of the underlying implant. So I took the patient. He presented to me in the month of 2017, in the ninth month of 2017. So I took him to the surgery immediately. Actually, there is a scheme in our hospital in Karnataka, like for physically handicapped people, the government is sponsoring 1 lakh rupees per patient. So I applied this boy for that scheme and got sanctioned of about 20,000 rupees. So just for the ring purpose, they sanctioned 20,000 rupees and I could operate on him. So I took him for surgery and did an excision of hematoma, as you can see in this picture. This is a very important step in management of CPT. We have to remove all the hematomous tissue till the normal bone and normal periosteum is seen. As you can see in this picture, I approached tibia and fibula separately with the incision. So I will come up with a later what is the difficulty with this type of approach. Normally, I used to do in a single incision, approach the tibia as well as fibula. So, but in this patient, I approached it separately and landed up with little difficulty. So after I excised the hematoma, then I had to harvest the periosteal bone graft. So here you can see This is a 7-year-old boy. He had a very good thick periosteum. I harvested it from the inner table of the ilium, just beneath the iliacus muscle. You can see here on the left picture, I elevated iliacus muscle from the periosteum and then separated the periosteum from the inner table of the ilium. So this almost the square type of periosteum was harvested from the inner side. And then also I harvested some bone graft also. So in this manner, I wrapped the periosteum, that is the inner layer of the periosteum, that is cambium layer, should be facing the bone. And then I tied up the periosteum around the excised bone, and then inserted little bone graft which I harvested from the ilium. Before doing this, I inserted the intramedullary rod, maybe a L wire or a thick K wire from the calcaneum. So this is how I do, and I wrapped the non-union site with periosteum and bone graft. So this is the X-ray picture. You can see the intramedullary rod inside the distal and the proximal fragment. And here was the skin incision. So later, what happened? There was a blowout of the suture. It got infected. And then you can see at the end of 12th month, there was gradual resorption of the bone. So, but I continually tried doing the compression, and gradually there was absorption of the distal fragment and absorption of the bone graft also. But I continued gradual compression. At the January 2018, it started showing signs of union at the non-union site. I did not do lengthening in this patient because there was an inflammation when the patient presented to me. So I just waited for the patient. But that waiting has helped me, because if I would have done the proximal corticotomy at this time, I would have landed with a complication. So after 8 months, the non-union united. This was the picture. And this was the X-ray picture after the removal of the ring. And this is after 8 months, this was the picture. I had given him orthosis of this type. He was walking, he's walking very comfortably now. 1 year, 7 months after Elisero removal. And this is the picture. Recently, he came to me before a lockdown. He came to me, and this was his walking picture. He's walking very comfortably, and okay. And now, how to manage the limb length discrepancy in CPT? So. I have experience of about 8 cases now. For 3 cases, I have done primary lengthening. One patient, I had a refracture. So I thought of doing a limb lengthening on the subsequent after 2 years. So when I searched for the literature, there were very few studies published on equalizing limb length discrepancy, tibial lengthening. So one of the study published in BMC Musculoskeletal Disorder, he suggested, he had experience of 11 cases. So according to him, according to the author, tibial lengthening should be done after 2 years, after primary union. If the limb length discrepancy was more than 4 centimeters. So according to the author, the advantage of tibial lengthening after 2 years, performing the tibial lengthening of 2 years of CPT union, he believed that walking with protective orthosis improve the blood circulation of tibia, and hence it increases the density of the bone, and which helps in good callus formation and regeneration when we do a corticotomy after 2 years of CPT union. It also, this method also decreases the healing index and axonal fixation time. So the take-home message is Elizaro gives 100% union rate at the CPT site. And according to me, approach fibula in the same incision. And periosteal osteograft, autograft is ideal way of managing. Always protect tibia with intramedullary rod to prevent refracture. And no need of lengthening. Recently, we had a lecture by Dr. Dror Pale. He also suggested that he doesn't do any lengthening primarily. So he, according to the legend, he says the growth catches up as subsequently, if we operate CPT patient on a young child. So I followed the same thing now, and I don't do lengthening primarily. And I have seen some of my patient catching the growth. And if it doesn't happen, then we can always have option of lengthening later on. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, for your nice and short presentation. And Bari sir, I think we may just complete the presentation, then we go for the interaction session and question answer session.
Okay, now
I am requesting Junjunala sir for his presentation. Junjunala sir, can you hear me? Junjunala sir, can you hear me? Please go for your next presentation. And Shatish sir and for Junjunala sir, their information, there are lots of questions to me in the inbox regarding the pseudoarthrosis. I think we can discuss it just after the Junjunala sir presentation. Junjunala sir, please unmute your microphone. Yes, and please go for the screen sharing.
Just one minute.
Yes, sir, okay. We're waiting. Everyone is requested to send the question to my chat box so that we can have discussion. Today, I will ask the question to the presenter directly from the chat box. And the congenital pseudoarthrosis tibia is a very interesting thing, and you have lots of questions. So you can ask directly to the legendary professor Junjunala sir and also to the professor Shatish sir.
लोड हो रहा है कितनी देर रहेगा नहीं मालूम
Okay, we can see the
screen. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, can I start?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, you can start, sir.
This is the management of infected non-union with user of fixator. Infected non-union. Non-union of long bones associated with infection has always been a challenge to the orthopedic surgeon. There are coexisting factors also along with the infection you have to look after. There is loss of bone, there is soft tissue damage, limb length discrepancy, soft tissue atrophy, because if a patient is not walking and patient is lying down, so there is soft tissue atrophy, neurovascular compromise maybe, and there may be osteoporosis because the patient is not walking and taking weight for a long time because of non-union. Variable results have been reported with staged reconstruction with immobilization of the limb in a plaster or external fixator and cancellous bone grafting or vascularized free tissue graft. Most patients managed with these undergo multiple surgical procedures. Despite the results, these patients undergo a seemingly unproductive course of treatment in which the level of disability related to a long bone fracture can actually counterbalance benefit of limb salvage. By variable results, by doing all these external fixator and vascularized free graft, it all takes long time. So the level of disability related to a long bone fracture can actually counterbalance benefit of limb salvage. Professor G. Elizaro from Kurgan in the 1960 developed osteosynthesis technique combining mechanical and biological factors. The technique involved removal of non-viable tissue, all foreign bodies, or hardware, application of constructed wire fixator ring frame, and correction by distraction osteogenesis or by compression. This was the Elizaro's treatment history. In 1841, Edward Hartstone introduced the word pseudoarthrosis in his monogram, which described a wide variety of non-surgical methods. So the pseudoarthrosis was first described by Edward Hartstone in 1841. In 1855, Henry Smith of Philadelphia described a method based on the rationale of pressure and motion of the fractured site. In 1950, LBJ advocated bone grafting and massive allograft. He took the bone graft from the iliac crest and even from the tibia, normal tibia, and did the bone grafting. Chutro in 1980 described cancellous strip grafting and principles of sparing elevation of periosteum. Hemister in 1930 rejected cancellous strips and advocated full thickness cortical graft along with its endothelial surface. He used a full thickness cortical graft. In 1970, Papineau described open bone grafting till granulation tissue forms and later skin grafting can be done. He used to put cancellous bone at the fracture site, non-union site, and keep it open so that the granulation starts from the bone, and once the granulation comes, they used to put the skin graft. And Professor Elizaro in 1960 described his technique, which I have shown already. This is his technique, involved removal of non-viable tissue, all foreign bodies or hardware, application of constructed wire fixed to ring, that is leather of frame, and correction by distraction osteogenesis or by compression. And he stated, infection burns in the fire of the regenerate. In order to eradicate infection, obtain union and a functional limb, one often needs to take courageous measures, hence increasing the risk of failures. Regular principle of debridement, stabilization, and antibiotic therapy result in an acceptable cure for less severe type of infection. For more severe or recalcitrant infection, one needs radical debridement, sometimes plastic procedures with application of stable fixator to attain bony union. Normally, there are options in diaphyseal non-unions. And what are the normal options? One is extensive debridement and local soft tissue flap, free microvascular flaps and bone transplant, Boyd's procedure, Papineau's cancellous grafting, intramedullary fixation, internal fixation with plates and screws, external fixation, unilateral fixator. Sometimes you may require fibrillectomy, cast application, electrical stimulation, and arthrotripsy. These are the different methods which you can do it for normal bone in a normal fashion and normal option. Weber had classified non-unions like hypervascular or hypertrophic type, that is elephant foot, horse hoof, hoof type, or oligotrophic type. Avascular, that is atrophic type, is torsion wedge type, comminuted type, gap type, and atrophic type. Elizar described, classified non-union as stiff, less than 7 degrees movement at the fracture site, and lax when there is more than 7 degrees movement at the fracture site. Dor Palet described and classified in 1980s to consider presence of infection, deformity, bone loss, and mobility at the non-union site. Aseptic non-union without bone loss, he described as A1 as lax and A2 as stiff. Aseptic non-union with bone loss. Bone loss, no shortening, fibula intact. B2 is shortening, no bone loss, overlap. B3, bone defect and shortening. And C, he described as infected non-union, lax with infection, stiff without deformity with infection, stiff with deformity with infection, and C4, infected non-union with poor skin and presence of sinuses. Debridement is the removal of all dead tissues along with the radical resection of bone till healthy margins are obtained. This is identified by punctate bleeding from the bone edges, and that is called a paprika set. You go on excising the avascular bone on proximally as distally as you get punctate bleeding. And that is a paprika sign when you get it. Till that time, you go on excising slowly, slowly, little, little bone from the different non-union site. And then you open the medullary canal proximally as well as distally. Then you do the corticotomy and the following distraction osteogenesis, which also increases blood supply of the limb, eradicates the infection. The higher corticotomy at the proximal level increases definitely the blood supply of the limb, and therefore for CPT also, if you do the same time corticotomy at the higher level, the whole limb blood supply increases by because of that corticotomy, and which helps in the union of the non-union bone. And then you do compression of fracture ends, and sometimes bone grafting are required to achieve union. Elizaros ring fixator used for stabilization, mechanical stability, and facilitates axial macromotion. Compression, fibrous tissue can be compressed to stimulate osteogenesis. Distraction, Professor Elizaros demonstrated that bone forms under the tension stress too. Used for hypertrophic non-union with shortening. When there is a hypertrophic non-union, you can do distraction, and which causes a new bone formation, and your lengthening can occur, and the union can also occur. Or bone transport, this can be arranged, this can be managed, sorry. This can be managed by proximal or distal corticotomy or both. A separated but viable bone fragment, hence created, is transported through the defect by manipulation of the apparatus. By manipulation of the Elizaros frame and apparatus. Case records of patients treated with Elizaros ring fixator for tibia fractures at Bombay Hospital, Mumbai, from February 96 to October 10, were retrospectively studied. Most of the patients with the infected non-union were taken as included in the criteria. Gap non-union and terminated open fractures, union would not have been possible without surgical intervention are taken into consideration. Patients treated with internal fixation where implant failed, leading to non-union, then treated with Elizaros were included. Non-unions after pathological fractures were excluded from this study. 40 patients with 41 tibial non-unions were treated with the Elizaros ring fixator. Sorry. There were 34 males and 7 females with a mean age of 32 years. Infection was clinically present in all cases. There were 6 patients with gap non-union at presentation, but after debridement, there were total 13 patients who needed bone transport. So there were hypervascular, that is hypertrophic non-union, were 29 cases, and atrophic cases were 28 These are the closed fracture, 7 cases. Type 1 open fracture in 3 cases, type 2 in 14 cases, type 3 in 7 cases, type 3B was in 8 cases, and type 3C is 2 cases. So 27 patients had monofocal synthesis with corticotomy and 13 needed bone transport. The mean defect before fixator application in 13 cases treated by bone transport was 4.65 centimeter, range from 2 centimeter to 8 centimeter. This is a case where there were multiple sinuses. This patient was treated by external fixator for a long time, and that's why you can see his leg is so atrophic. Fixed equinus deformity, blackish and defective and defect deformity. So when this patient came, we have formed a pre-construction Elizaros frame with the Elizaro for the equinus deformity also to correction. We have attached this frame with the main frame. And this was the patient leg, you can see. And this was the frame which was put on this after debridement. And first, this equinus was corrected gradually, and compression was given here. After 7 months, patient could walk with the frame with full weight. And after removal of frame, very good result. Leg absolutely normal. Equinus completely corrected. Another case with grade 3B comminuted tibia fracture, lower 1/4 tibia with the external fixator. You can see here comminuted pieces. We had done the debridement, removed all avascular tissues, and then a microvascular skin latissimus graft was put on the area which was all open, and external fixator was continued to use. Once the microvascular flap matured, then we put the Elizaro and did the corticotomy, here, and transported this whole tibia down. And you can see here, the whole tibia has come down, and the leg was looking more or less normal. Good result after 8 months. This was the closed fracture of the tibia, operated by someone, converted to open infected non-union. Those people who don't know how to operate, they convert a normal non-union, normal fracture into infected non-union. After debridement, you can see here, there was a gap. And then we put the Elizaro frame. This is the Elizaro frame. And a corticotomy has done at the higher level and brought this, transported this fragment down till it docks here. This happened after 6 months of, it took docking 6 months. And after docking also, there was a slight movement at the docking site. So to stabilize that, we have put one small interfragmentary screw. This is the interfragmentary screw so that this docking site became stable and united. And meanwhile, a 13 centimeter from year to year, regenerate has formed, which was good and stabilized the bone. Another case, post-traumatic equinus deformity. We have put the Elizaro equinus frame and corrected gradually. Full correction after it. Another case, a grade 3 BRI, this was grade 3 B tibia fracture, not attended for a long time. So there was the avascular bone became sequestrated. So we did the debridement, removed the avascular bone that is sequestrated. And then he was put on external fixator. There was a gap non-union. And Elizaro was put, corticotomy was done, and transported. You can see here the docking site, these were the gap, these were the regenerate and transported fragment, and gradually it healed up in 3 months' time. So you can see after 1 year, very good regenerate here, good bone formation, and docking site healed up. At this stage, the frame was removed. This was the another case, infected plating was done, infected plate with non-union. Plate was removed, debridement was done. Elizaro was put. This was the hypertrophic type of non-union. So compression was given at the fracture site, and it consolidated in 8 months' time. Another case, ipsilateral neck shaft. He had a fractured neck, he had a fractured shaft, and he has a fracture, supracondylar TY fracture. So this was fixed with the screws. Neck was fixed with the screws, and the shaft was treated with external fixator. After the infection was controlled, we have removed the screws and external fixator, and we did vanconail, that is vancomycin mixed with cement, and a nail is prepared with the cement. This is the nail inside. Over that, there is cement was put with vancomycin, and we call that as vanconail. And the whole this, along with the cement, this nail was put inside the femur, and gradually the femur healed up. Infection got controlled along with the antibiotics intravenously. The infection got controlled, and this vancomycin with the nail operates locally, which gives local concentration of antibiotic, so that the intramedullary infection heals up very well, and you can get a union. So conclusion is, Elizaro method offered certain specific advantages over traditional technique of treatment of non-unions. It can address bone defect, soft tissue loss, correction of deformity, and limb length discrepancy simultaneously. Union achieved primarily in most cases, though minor problems require additional procedures. Control of infection can be achieved satisfactorily by thorough debridement of soft tissues and avascular bone ends via primary compression if defect is small, or transport if defect is large. I would recommend this use of this technique in the management of infected non-unions, specifically of tibia. But due to the duration of treatment involved and possible complications, patient selection has to be careful, and proper counseling is required for the patient before commencement of the treatment, because the treatment period is very long. Sometimes patients get fed up with the Elizaro ring, and they cannot do walking. But once the firmness of the union occurs, patients start walking with the Elizaro ring. Thank you for your kind attention. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation, especially the congenital pseudoxia of tibia and also the infected non-union. Both are the very burning issue for the orthopedic surgeon, and very problematic issue. And we got your task from your huge experience. So everyone can enrich their knowledge and their clinical practice by taking this type of cases as a reference. Sir, I request you to please stop your screen share so that we can go to the participation mode and question answer session, sir.
Yeah. About CPT, hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
About CPT, what Pele has given lecture.
Yes, sir.
He has devised a new technique.
Yes, sir.
Where he exercises the pseudo-arthrotic area and does lot of grafting between the tibia and fibula, so that there is a union between the fibula and the tibia. And
yes,
once you do the union between here, we try to do the union between tibia and fibula. You cannot do lengthening of the tibia, and that's why he said that he do a lengthening of in second stage. But if you try to do the lengthening when you do the compression at the fracture site, and you can do lengthening which improves the circulation of the limb, circulation of the whole tibia more than normal, and that helps for the union also.
Union of
the, so yes. This method, there are two different methods which are separate.
Yes, sir, we got that idea. Sir, can you please stop the screen share?
Yeah, okay. अरे अजीरत को बुलाना
after the presentation we are now in participation mode. I will request Bari sir, please give the overall comments about the 2-3 session, and today we will go for a little bit different way. We will go for the chat box for the question, because many questions already in my chat box, and if anyone have any new thing to add, he can add by just raising his hand, and at the end we will go sequentially to different participant. So from now, after Bari sir, we will go to the presentation question mode, and you can ask any question regarding the CPT and non-UTM to Jindimala sir and to Shotish sir, and also to Professor Bari sir, and even the other participant, the renowned professor who are connected with us, can pass their comments regarding any answer or his opinion, what is new in CPT or in infected non-immune. So I am going to the participation mode. Okay. Okay. Welcome back, Bari sir. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Sir. So you already heard that today we changed a little bit differently. So please go on your comments of the overall session. We will go to the question answer session, because it is very much interesting session, and everyone is waiting for the questions that they answer for the questions that they sent to me. Bari sir,
how many questions Arif already in your chat box?
Sir, already 5, 6, 7 questions, sir.
7 questions. Okay, I'll finish within a short time. Thank you very much, Junjunwala sir, Shatish.
Thank you, sir.
For elaborately, sir, you mentioned regarding the CPT, congenital pseudoarthritis of the tibia and infected non-union of the tibia. And one case was shown by Dr. Shatish, was very interesting. And because since we are working with the Elizarov technique, and I am getting a lot of infected non-union in my country, just like India, and CPT also I have done. Regarding the Professor Dror Pele's cross union, I have done 4 cases, and I had 1 failure case. Maybe the this is due to my technical fault. And 3 cases was good, and the cases was shown by Professor Junjunwala. The technique was already the in Kurgan Center. They are following that. They are following the same technique. And sir, you have used in most of the cases. I have seen the pins also. But in Gurgaon Center in TBR, they don't use the pins in CPT. And except neurofibromatosis, von Recklenhausen's disease, in without this, other cases, their union is 95 to 100%. But refracture rate is 50 to 55%. Professor Dror Pele, for the last 9 or 10 years, is fighting with 36 cases, showing all the time. And 4 or 5 times I have seen his cases. This is a very good system, but because CPT is a disease of the periosteum, whole periosteum is involved. And he is getting a lot of periostal stripping, the old case that is 12 years old, the Shotish was showing that one. He's taking a lot of periosteal graft. And I also took that one. Now it is a time consuming, very good operation, but long-term follow-up, he has shown that 100% union and no refracture rate. Still, I cannot pass any comment regarding his 36 cases. I am just listening all the time, this cross union of, and he has taken this cross union from Korea, Choi's method, how to collect the bone from. And he has established that one combination of Elizaro and plating and inside the telescopic knee. So regarding the non-union, of course, Elizarov is the best technique other than any other external fixator, because multi-axial, multi-planar, and when you are doing corticotomy, that is just controlling the infection, and at the same time, you can increase the vascularity of the whole limb. And this vascularity, I'm telling all the time, when you are doing corticotomy, 330% vascularity is increased in case of corticotomy, and then go for bone transportation. So overall, session was good. We have learned a lot of things. And I think all our participants, they have heard the experience of the Professor Junjunwala and experience of Shotish Nasari. Thank you very much. Now you can enjoy the question and answer session, and probably we'll learn from you also.
Thank you, sir, for your nice words. And today, if you have any question or want to pass any comments, please put your hands up and I will unmute your microphone and you can interact. Otherwise, we'll go to the question and answer session. The first question to Junjunwala sir from Nazmul Huda Shetu. The CPT always occur in the distal limb, not in the proximal part. Why there is any explanation regarding this, sir?
That is the congenital formation of fibrous tissue at the lower part of the tibia. Why that occurs, nobody knows.
Yes, sir. I think Nazmul Huda Shetu got his answer. And sir, there is a question from Ghulam Mustafa. In CPT, you have shown that you do the bone transport and acute docking. And do you do any bone graft in the CPT, sir?
Only in one case I have done bone grafting there. The docking site was not uniting faster. So I have put bone graft, cancellous bone graft.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I think Ghulam Mustafa, you got the answer. Now I am going to show
the docking site must unite.
Yes, sir.
In 3 months' time, once the docking has occurred. But if it takes longer time, you do the bone grafting so that in 2 months' time, the docking site heals up. And your regenerate also becomes more stronger.
Okay, sir.
All my 11 cases, there was only one case refracture, and which healed up with just white plaster. Just white plaster immobilization, it healed up. Only one case had a fracture after 2 years.
Sir, I have a question regarding this issue to you. Sir, of the author just suggest to protect the bones for a very long time. In case of after the removal of the ring, what is your protocol regarding the protection of the treated limb after the CPT union?
In one case, the bone was very thin, so the very thin bone can break any time, and therefore I had given her a caliper. In another case, the bone was very weak, osteoporotic, where I had given a plastic mold. So it all depends upon, and give little support by doing caliper or by doing a plastic mold.
Okay,
or
sir.
At least 1 year till the bone becomes strong enough. After 1 year, you take the X-ray, see what is the difference between the girth of the bone 1 year back and now, and then according to that, you can give the support.
Okay, thank you, sir. And now I am going to Shotish Nisasiri, sir. We have seen your cases and I have question. What is your opinion regarding the ex-union protocol of Dor Pele? And the another question is that what about the intermedullary rodding or any internal fixation device to stay in this type of treated pseudoarthrosis after union? How much protection you want to pay for to provide the patient after the union? Shortish, sir.
Thanks, Dr. Arif. Regarding cross union, I have no experience. I have not done because I'm quite happy with what I'm doing. And this cross union, it requires a lot of bone graft and a lot of BMP also. So BMP is out of question in my hospital setup because mine is a government setup. So that much bone graft cannot be harvested from a small child, and that is also out of question. So I have not done any cross unions. I have no experience, but I am quite happy with this method, what I have been doing. And regarding the second question regarding use of intramedullary rod. So one thing, it helps in getting the alignment, one. Second is, it prevents refracture. And regarding when to remove this and how much time to keep intramedullary rod is up to the maturity. Up to 16 to 18 years, I keep changing the intramedullary rod now and then. And so this is how I manage. And regarding walking, immediately after the fixator removal, I will give a brace and patient immediately starts walking once he is out of ring.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I have a question to Professor Bari sir and Junjunwala sir also, and to you. Sir, one of your cases, you just stated that you encountered the osteopenia a little bit and a rarefication of the bones at the some part of your treatment. Sir, sometimes in our clinical practice, after putting the Elizarov ring, in some cases, the callus or even the bone get osteopenic. So what is your strategy to prevent this type of osteopenia and to increase the regenerate also? This is
question. This is general question or in CPT?
Sir, general question, CPT. Sir. CPT also and general question. You can
if regenerate formation is less.
Yes,
then,
sir.
And if regenerate formation is less.
Yes, sir.
Then I don't distract 1 millimeter per day. I distract only 0.5 millimeter per day. That means every 6 hours, 4 times in a day, if you distract, I do it in twice a day only. 1/4 millimeter, that is 0.5 millimeter a day. Plus, I make them walk. If they walk with the patient taking weight, the osteopenia disappears gradually and your regenerate also becomes strong enough. Plus, give them proteins and lot of proteins and vitamin D and calcium so that they can form, regenerate more stronger. And in children, it forms, the regenerate forms very well without any problem. Till your compression site becomes solid, your regenerate also becomes solid.
Sir, you have given the answer. Good answer.
Yes, sir.
I am giving you the answer. Listen.
Yes, sir.
When something new is coming, regenerate bone, new bone. Yeah. What is coming? Dermatogenesis, neurogenesis. See, just like a coronavirus, neurogenesis, angiogenesis, everything is coming, bone, tissue genesis, myogenesis, and there will be osteopenia, the very thing. And at the same time, the transosseous wires, when it vibrates, this is, you should have to accept that one, you should have to tell your patient that it will happen, and you should have to accept that. You cannot, even then, if you prescribe the vitamin B1, B6, B12 for that, you cannot stop that one. And at the same time, what Junjunal Asad told, you should have to walk. And if you think that patient is complaining pain, then you can stop your time, your rhythm and rate. And at the same time, that's why in Kurgan Center, they have developed the automatic 60 times a day. And now I am also using, I told you, 0.125, 8 times a day. If you go for distraction 8 times a day, there will be less pain. These are the things.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
I think the junior doctors and also the new beginner have got the idea, because sometimes the osteopenia in the regenerate or in bony part, you need not to worry about. Please keep look on the movement of the patient, and also the Barisa told that if we increase the distraction by a more physiological rate, that is more times but the same amount, as much you increase the times of your distraction within the 1 millimeter per day, then it will go most physiological rate. So please keep it in mind. Now I am going to Gholam Farooq sir. Gholam Farooq sir, if you can hear me, please have your comments about the CPT treatment, and if you have anything to add, sir.
So nothing to add. The oil presented by Professor Jindrala and oil said by Professor Bari. I have some questions. The rate of refracture, Jindrala sir said it is very, out of 11 cases, you have one single fracture, refracture. I like to know in the case of refracture, again he do the same procedure or do anything new else?
Junjunala sir, you got the question, sir?
For the treatment of the refracture cases, what you have done?
Sir,
you
only applied the same procedure, one refracture occurred where this boy was very, very, very naughty. He fell down while running. And that's why he got a fracture, which I treated only by plaster. Plaster immobilization, and it healed up well in 6 weeks' time. He got a fracture mid-shaft because of fall while running.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. There is a question to Junjunala.
Dr. Arif.
Yes, sir.
I want to share my own experience about the CPT.
Yes, sir.
Just to share.
In
external protocol, I did about 4 cases in Nitur. Yes. Just I learned it from my Bari sir. Then I applied it in Nitur. But there is a great problem. I have also done about 4 cases. One case is very successful, but other cases not successful at all. Because
I have 3 cases under treatment. I have 3 cases of CPT are under treatment. At present.
Yes. At present in under treatment.
Yeah.
Oh, one is a great problem. There is the implant that is a telescopic rod. One case, the telescopic rod, it is not glided within the female part. It is blocked. So it is a problem. And another thing is there is a valgus deformity in the ankle. Another thing, there is a atrophy at the, again, atrophy at the side of pseudarthrosis. These are the common problems. And I face these problems. Then again, these patients are underwent on Elizarov method and upper tibial corticotomy. That will be helpful for the patient. Now I'm showing that there is a union and upper tibial corticotomy, that is lengthening is occurring.
If patient is showing atrophy, that means you have not excised the whole avascular or pathological bone. You must excise one millimeter extra. Then when you think that it is enough, you do 1 millimeter more, so that you are 100% sure that you have excised all the pathological fractured bone. So my 1 millimeter maybe, extra bone is always better.
Another.
Once you do the transportation, you can do whether you do 5 centimeter or you do 6 centimeter. It doesn't matter.
Can I throw another message?
Yes, sir.
Another message for everyone. Professor Shivso was always telling me regarding CPT. He told me, "Buddy, mind it." What, sir? Whenever you do CPT with neurofibromatosis patient, Recklinghausen's disease, don't do this neurofibromatosis, that is CPT, before 10. Why? Why? I asked him. He told me, because result of CPT with neurofibromatosis is not good. But the parents of the child always insist the doctor, please do it, do it. And doctor thinking about that, they said, I should do it. If I do it, I'll get money. Then doctor is going to do that. And classification was Anderson. I followed that classification all the time, not the Boyd's. Anderson, in his life, he has done 14 cases. And most of the cases he has done for amputation. In Western world, they are doing amputation. But in Kurgan, they never suggest for amputation. You should have to counsel the patient. This is the disease like this. And always you should have to think about the prognosis of the prognosis of this CPT. And in my life, what I have done, the late cases CPT, I got always good result. That is at the age of 7, 8, 9, 10, 12, 13, 14, 15. If I do it before 3 or 4, then maximum cases I face problem. This is the fact. Correct. I'm telling you.
Another thing.
Yes, sir.
My 2 or 3 cases without the Exonium protocol, that was that I learned from the Kurgan, only with the Elizarov ring, that is better. Patient needs more time to heal, and union is very good. And there is a one case is a valgus deformity with again anterior angulation occur. And I advise the patient to do again the Elizarov method after a few days. And of these two, I think only Elizarov method without any nail, without any, it's a better option, I think. It's my comment. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Asmuluta, sir. I have a question to Bari, sir, and Jujunala, sir. What is your age recommendation then? What is your age recommendation for starting the treatment of pseudoarthrosis of tibia, sir?
I do with Elizaro and I am very happy with that. How I have shown you my 3 cases are under treatment already now at present because of the
sir, I am
not here. I have not seen them last 3 months. What is happening to those cases?
Sir, what is your age recommendation for starting the treatment, sir, CPT?
After 4 years, do it whenever the patient comes to you.
After 4 years?
If patient comes at the age of 8, you cannot ask him to come at 4. Why did not you come at 4? You have to do it at 8. I have done cases at 8 years, 7 years, 10 years, 14 years also.
Sir, same case. The question was raised by Dr. Nagmunuddha Shetu. Sometimes it happened. I got in my life recurvatum of the upper part of the tibia and pseudoarthrosis in the lower part of the tibia. Then you should have to go for osteotomy and putting the telescopic small children's size, and then you could put the Elizarov. Gives a good result. But I have the you know, sir, both kinds of experience regarding the corticotomy, without corticotomy, CBT, because it is easy now for me to do this and this. But outcome, before doing that, I always now counsel the patient, please, these are the problems you will face. I tell the parents. When I was younger, then I told everything will be okay, no problem. Now I tell the problem first. Even then, patient agrees with me. Yes, you do.
Good, sir.
So this is the these
are
the
you are a good surgeon.
Thank you, sir.
And regarding the ex-union protocol, Dr. Pelle sir used to say this, you have to follow all my points. If you just leave on my points, you will not, you cannot get the good result. So there are a different ideology. And now I am going to the question of the chat box. So there is a question from ASM Abdullah. Some author said oxygen level at the oxygen level at the pseudoesthesis site is less. Would you please tell me the reason? Satish sir, do you get that question? Yes, sir.
Yeah, this answer to the Abdullah sir. As we, if we go to the anatomy of the tibia, if you see the nutritional blood supply to the tibia, there are two nutritional blood vessels to the upper part and only one to the lower part.
Right, exactly.
Right.
100% right.
Yes. So this is the reason because to say that it, there is a low oxygen level at the lower third tibia site. I hope.
There is a question from no ID is that, sir, can you tell me about the periosteal bone graft affection site? I think that this issue is already discussed regarding the ex-union protocol. And now I am going to another question.
Arif.
Yes, sir.
Adikulle is raising all the time, 3 or 4 times raising hand.
Sir, I am going to him just a minute.
I'm sorry. He's raising all the time.
Yes, sir. There is a question from Professor Shamol Kumar Devnath, sir. CPT and posterior medial bowing, how does the deformity occur in two directions? Sir, already add that in CPT in one limb and posterior medial bowing in other limb. Can it be happen? He want to know about this.
Usually it is posterior lateral bowing occurs. I don't know. I have not seen a posterior medial bowing.
Sir, a patient with one limb with CPT and other limb with posterior medial bowing. Sir, is just eager to know that. Can it be happen or is there any explanation?
No.
Okay, sir. Another question from the Shamol, sir. Why do the regenerate in CPT after healing remains sclerotic? Junjunala sir?
Sorry. Yes.
Why do the regenerate in CPT after healing remains sclerotic?
I didn't follow it.
Sir, question is, I am giving the answer.
Yes, sir.
CPT is a disease of the periosteum hole. And when we are putting the Elizarov, biomechanically stable fixator is the Elizarov.
Yeah.
Biomechanically more stable Elizarov than other all external fixators, because here we are using only the wires, you know, and we are increasing circulation a little bit. That's why little bit, not 100%. So bones are sclerotic.
I use Elizarov as hybrid. I put two in the proximal part, two wires and one shunt screw, so that you have a good stable frame. And most important is that make the patient walk on that frame. The Elizarov frame is allowed to make the patient to walk.
Yes.
No other external fixator allows the patient to walk and take full weight, except Elizarov ring fixator. And
right.
That's why the Elizarov ring fixator is superior to any other external fixator.
External fixator.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir. Sir, there is a question from me. Sir, you and Bari, sir, suggested us the at least 4 years of age is the best age for starting the treatment, but some author start the treatment more earlier. more earlier, even 2 years of age. What is your comments about the starting in more earlier?
Arif.
Yes, sir.
If you go for the cross union by Dror Pale.
Yes, sir.
You can start at the age of 6 months, 8 months.
Yes, sir.
1 year, no barrier, because he is giving a lot of bone grafting, making a full link, periosteal bone graft, 30 to 50. Have you seen that one?
Yes, sir.
Making full and giving in the whole length of the bone tibia, length. Both sides.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, this side, this side. That's why he's getting cross union. That is no barrier for the cross union choi method grafting. I call this choi method. And our method that we are using, that is quite different. That is, I tell you, after 4, this is good. If I get 8-9 years, that is very good.
Okay, sir, we got that answer. Sir, there is another question. If there are different types of CPT, but there is no fracture, if the patient come to you, do you recommend to do Elizarov for this patient, sir?
This is very good question. Then again, you should have to APA lateral view, you should calculate all the angles. If bowing like the CPT, you should have to do the osteotomy correction of, otherwise you'll get the refracture later on. Correction, yes, you should have to do. And I have the cases, I can show you 3 or 4 cases like that, CPT, bowing. And I have corrected that one, which is a fixator, doing the osteotomy in different level.
Okay. Shrotish sir, you want to add anything, sir?
Actually, Bari sir exactly told what I wanted to tell. Regarding operating in a patient less than 4 years, if the patient doesn't have fracture, no need to operate. If the patient has fracture, then only operate. So I hope everybody agrees with this.
Thank you, sir. I'm just requesting the participant to follow the every particular details of CPT. Many times we do the mistake and we cannot take decision when we have to operate, when we don't have to operate, and what the study disease we have to take. So now I'm going to Adikunle, sir. Sir, you are open for asking any question. Adikunle, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah,
I'm ready to hear the question.
Okay. I have 3 questions there.
Yes, sir.
Well, the questions is, it's on the non-union, the tibia non-union. I noticed that in the cases he presented, there was no deviation of the degenerate, even as far as 8 centimeter lengthening. What was the trick there? That's number one. Then number two, we all know that the anatomy of the tibia is subcutaneous in most part, especially on the medial side. So in a situation in which there is bone loss, do you do skin grafting before lengthening, or you fix your hardware and then graft and then do skin grafting? Let me repeat that part again, because that's very important to me. The tibia is subcutaneous in most parts, in the medial part.
Yes, sir.
So in a situation in which there is bone loss and you want to do lengthening, do you do a skin graft there first before you start your lengthening, or you put your hardware and then you lengthen? Then the third question, if while you are lengthening and the fibula unites during lengthening, what do you do? That's all.
I
think
your last question, the fibula unites earlier, and that's why the tibia doesn't go for union. And therefore, if you want tibia to unite, you have to do corticotomy of the fibula. Then only there is a compression at the tibial site, and therefore that unites. If you do just corticotomy of the fibula, it unites. The tibia unites. Okay, that is your third question. Second question is that skin graft, you have to do it to prevent the further infection. If the skin is closed completely, the infection will not occur. Otherwise, if you do the lengthening, your regenerate will get infected if the wound is open. So you have to do skin grafting and see that your wound is not open, so that less chances of infection. Right? And what is your first question?
Sir, hold on, sir.
What is your first question?
No, I'm not satisfied fully. I understand what you said on the second question. The second question, two more.
Yes, sir.
So for the second question, you have to do this skin grafting first, so that there is no chance of infection to the regenerate. So the skin grafting has to be first. The wound completely.
Sir, I think Adekula said you got that message that you first of all, you have to decrease the exposed surface area, because when the skin is bleached, the chance of infection and the morbidities of the patient will be more. So you have to just keep this in mind, and after that, you can do the lengthening and anything. There is no contraindication of lengthening after the skin graft. So can you please repeat your first question?
Okay, I said, I noticed that there was no deviation. What was the trick?
Sorry. No deviation from the union side, in the union side.
Sorry, I could not get it.
Sir, can you...
Sir, dog inside, no deviation. What is the tricks?
Okay. Because your transported fragment must be held with two wires at two places, so that it doesn't deviate. It comes down properly. It has to have two places hold, so that it comes down. If there is only one place hold, it will deviate.
Understand?
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Yes, sir. Thank you, Adekunle sir, for being connected. And another thing is that there is a deviation of docking in place where there is a large gap, and it is very frequent. And I think Janjula sir will agree that if it is large gap and you docked in a site and some skin or other thing is interposed, you may need to freshen it, and at the time you can just make the good docking. Now a question to Janjula sir. From myself, sir. Just think about a patient with huge gap, and you have the option to do the fibula transport, and you have option for multifocal bone transport also. What is your preference, sir, in that situation? Large bone gap with two options.
If I feel that if it is more than 12 centimeter gap, I will do fibular graft.
Yes, sir.
Because to get 12 centimeter transportation will be very, very difficult. So my idea is to 10 to 12 centimeter, more than 12 centimeter, it is to do fibular transport, fibular
tibialization.
Tibialization of fibula, or more than less than 10 to 12 centimeter, you can do transportation. In one of the cases, I have shown you 13 centimeter transportation, 13 centimeter regenerate formation, but it took very, very long time. It took about a year. So patient difficult to keep the illusory frame for that much time.
Sir,
thank you, sir.
I just had this question. That is, is there any age bar regarding the tibialization of this large gap?
Okay, no age bar. No.
Oh.
No, it is one of the treatment of non-union.
Patient is about more than 50 years.
Tibialization is one of the treatment for the non-union gap, long gap. Non-union. It is one of the treatments. You can do anytime.
Thank you, sir. Now going to Bari, sir. Bari, sir, the same question to you.
Sorry, sir. Before Professor Bari speaks, Dr.
Sorry, sir. I'm coming to you, sir. Adikulle, sir.
Adikulle, Adikulle, Adikulle. He's angry, angry. He's upset.
Yes, sir. Please, please. You can send me the question in my chat box, sir. Also, is there a connection problem? Adikulle, sir. You can send the question in chat box also.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Please unmute.
Yes.
I want to hear his response between transporting a long segment of the tibia and doing a translation of the fibula. What was his response? My network was bad. I'm interested in that because I have a case at hand.
Yes, sir. Please stay connected. I am going to Bari sir for same issue. Bari sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Sir, the same question to you. You
Adikulle.
Sir, he's here.
If your gap is very big, listen, gap is very deep, more than 10 centimeter, 15 centimeter, okay, 12 centimeter, 13, you just transport your fibula to the center of the whole gap, proximally and distally, okay? Even then, if you don't want to do distally transport, you just denude, if you have a lower part of the tibia, just like this, and whole fibula is like this, and you can denude and you can pull it and fix it with the olive. You can do that. Or centrally, you can place the whole fibula. This is, as a result, you will time consume of, for the patient and for you will be okay. And you can do gradually a little bit. When you have bone is there, fresh case, you can do then and there on the same sitting. The patient has come to you with fresh case, big gap, got the trauma today in the morning, or tomorrow patient has come to you, you can do that in the same city, I tell you. Okay? If the late case, your gap is big, infected, and big gap non-union, you just, from the top side, do the osteotomy of the fibula obliquely, and gradually pulled, and you'll see a just like a S-shaped type of new bone regenerate, and that will support just like a your bump, bony bump there in the proximal side, and that is good. If your bone in the upper part, four fingers or five fingers, listen, four fingers means 8 centimeter. And in the lower part, your finger is 8 centimeter or 10 centimeter, you can tell your patient, I can transport from both sides. That is called trifocal osteosynthesis. Proximally, you do the osteotomy, and distally, you do the osteotomy, and you should put the guide wire so that your axis cannot deviate, the bone cannot deviate, and it will guide you to in the normal axis. You understand me? Adikulle?
Yes, sir.
My question is, sir, if you have the you are expert in bone technology, who is one you will prefer for a patient particularly?
If the patient is young means 15, 20, 25, I suggest both this one, this and this. Below 30, I suggest both. This is a young chap. Tolerance is very good. If patient is more than 40, 50, then I go for this fibular transportation one time, because old man thinking 50, 55, 60, you know, even if you can convince at the age of 50, 55, you can do that. Patient is agree, then you can do that. But for the young chap, both are open. 15, 16, 20, 25, they can easily take and tolerate. And for 8 months or one year, I think, for a good outcome, we should have to wait. And in reserve surgery, theory is everything must be done gradually.
No hurry. Thank you, sir. I think when there is a big gap, you got the information about it is your surgeon's preference and your patient condition and all the socioeconomic condition and the level of understanding of the patient is also important. Now, we are coming end of the session because already 2 hours left. I have the question to, I want to ask a question to Junjunwala, sir. Sir, you present the infected sir. What is your antibiotic protocol in case of post-operative patient with after treating this type of infected non-union with Elisarov technique?
For infected non-union, if it is a mild infection, yes. I do the culture sensitivity, and according to the sensitivity of the culture, I give the treatment for 3 weeks. I give 1 week intravenous and other 2 weeks oral treatment,
yes.
Oral antibiotics. But if the infection is very severe infection,
yes, sir.
Then according to the culture and sensitivity, I give intravenous 3 weeks intravenous antibiotics.
Post-operative period, sir?
Yeah, post-operatively 3 weeks.
3 weeks.
Of course, I start sir, one day earlier. You
like any local delivery system of any antibiotic in the infected non-union site?
No.
Okay,
no.
Sir. I think
we have seen in 70s, 80s, local antibiotic. We used to pass antibiotic from one side and take out from the other side. There are two tubes we used to put in the wound in the infected cases, but it was hardly working that time. So we don't do it now.
Okay, sir. I think this was a very nice...
VAC is better treatment now if the bone is still exposed and the wound is not completely healed up. VAC is the best treatment. VAC.
Yes, sir. We got your answer. And now we are coming at the end of the session. And I think
it's
a very good, interesting session. And I will go sequentially to the co-host, then Shati sir, Ghulam Farooq sir, Junjunwala sir, and Bari sir for the closing. Sir, Bari sir, do you want to add, sir?
No.
Bari sir?
Sir,
who is talking?
I add one thing. The birthday of Shatish sir. First, greetings to him. Happy birthday to Shatish sir.
We already told him.
We already told him.
Okay.
And many of us send the SMS. Chat box, wishing happy birthday. And now...
And Arif.
Yes, sir.
Overall comment from Junjunwala sir and Shatish, you can take a little bit regarding this. I think overall interaction was very good. Everybody was happy. A lot of discussions we have done. They can talk something a little bit.
Yes, sir. Okay. I'm just going to in this way. Now I'm going to Ghulam Mustafa as your co-host, please. Have your comments. And Samsuluda sir, if you are online, please, we want to connect with you also. Ghulam Mustafa, please make short comments out of the whole session. Ghulam Mustafa, can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, please.
Thank you, sir. Especially Junjunwala sir, Shatish sir, for your nice presentation. And that will be helpful for us. And thank you for everything.
Okay, thank you. Now I'm going to Nazmul Huda Shetu for your short comment.
It's a very beautiful session. And thank you, our Professor Junjunwala sir. And thank you, Shatish sir. And also our great Bari sir. And I always invite you for the next session. And please comment about our session, and we will enrich our next lecture according to your desire. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, Nazmul Huda Shetu sir. You know that our next session on the 20th of this month, and it will be on the complications of faulty technique, will be delivered by Ghulam Mustafa and Nazmul Huda Shetu. I'm requesting Samsul Huda sir, if he is online, please unmute yourself and have some comments. Samsul Huda sir, if you are...
Samsul Huda.
Hello.
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Yeah, actually, I'm on road right now. Okay, sir, I won't be commenting right now.
Okay, sir. Okay, then I hope to see you on the 20th of this month for live streaming. Also, I think the issue will be solved by this time now. And now I am coming to Shotish Ghulam Farooq, sir. Ghulam Farooq, sir, please make your short comments about the whole session.
Thank you, Arif. It is a large session, long session, about 2 hours, 10 minutes more than. The total session is enjoyable. Thank you, Arif, again. Thank you to Professor Junjunwala and happy birthday, Satish, and send a virtual cake. Nothing we can do that. Thank you again, all the fellow colleagues. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir. Now I'm going to Satish, sir. If you want to add anything, our overall comments, and also about this session. Satish, sir.
Yeah, it was a great talk by Junjunwala, sir. And again, Bari sir's comment were very useful. Again, it was a great learning for me today. A lot of things, new things I got to learn. So, a lot of new questions from the participants also. So, it's a very good initiative by Bangladeshi Russian Elizaro Kurgan Center team. So, even though I have not gone to Kurgan, so I am just refreshing myself. I am learning a lot of things, Kurgan things here. It's a great learning opportunity for me. I thank Bari sir and Arif sir and all the Bangladeshi team for giving me opportunity to learn, to make me learn something from this session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your nice words. And please stay with us for the rest of the session. And we have a plan for continuing this session for future development and educational purpose for advanced Elizarov and other case oist discussion for the later on. And now I'm going to Junjunwala, sir. Before going to Junjunwala, sir, I would like to thank the Ashok, sir, and Sansulda, sir, for their continuous support. And now I'm going to Junjunwala, sir. Please have some comments over the session. And I hope to you should always be with us in this our journey.
Thank you very much, Dr. Arif and Dr. Bari and other members of this group. And Dr. Satish Nisari and Dr. Ghulam Farooqi. I'm thankful to you that you have called me and given me opportunity to talk to you. I'm grateful. The questions you people are asking, from that also we learned so many things which we possibly had not told during the lecture. But after the questions are asked, so many things are learned by us also. So it is very good to have good questions. And to give answer for those questions is also very difficult sometimes. Thank you very much for inviting me. And I hope you have learned something from me, which is more grateful for me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your continuous effort for giving the many important things from your vast scope of experience. And now I'm going to Bari sir for concluding comments. And after that, we will conclude the session and inviting you for the next session. Bari sir.
Junjunwala sir, Satish sir, yeah. Thank you very much for joining us. And I myself learned from you all. I learned from my mistakes. A doctor is always a student. When he faces to a student, he dies. I am always a student. I would like to learn from you, from everyone. Thank you very much that you have joined us. And our group is very good, young, energetic group. And we are consulting every day almost what to do and how what to do and what we can do, what we can progress in further. We are talking every day among our, these are the group here. They're all my students. And they know better than me. I tell you. Lot of things they know better than me. Yes. I appreciate I appreciate their activities.
How you give teaching to them.
Oh, thank you, sir.
How you give teaching to them. That's why they can learn better than you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. Yeah. Again, see you.
Thank you, sir, for your nice comments. And always...
Thank you very much.
Very much. Now I'm ending the session, and you can see all the videos in our YouTube channel of Elizabeth Clinic, AUMC, and Ortho World. And till 20th of this month, I'm saying goodbye.
Another, we have lot of Nigerian fellows now, sir. Okay. Nigerian, they're so interested on Elizabeth. Oh,
okay.
Thank you very much.
Very good, very good.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.
My thanks to all those Nigerian fellows who are getting those lectures.
Sir, please stay in good health. And
we Chinedam, PRS, Edikulle. Oh, Huda is already here. Okay, bye-bye.
Hello, sir.
Okay, bye-bye. Thank you very much. Good to see you.
Bye.
All good faces. Okay.
Assalamu alaikum. See you next session.